It is 700 million years ago, and you are standing on the edge of a magnificent frozen ice shelf. This is the Proterozoic Eon of Earth's history, and the planet is in crisis. The entire globe has frozen, and even here, on the equator, icebergs are everywhere. This eon is a massive time frame of almost 2 billion years that saw the Earth transform from an inhospitable bacterial world to the dawn of our planet's first complex multicellular animals. It is extremely cold, and you see your breath misting in the air. You are dressed like an Antarctic explorer, wearing a heavy winter coat, snow boots, woolly beanie, and gloves. You're preparing two drones to take a closer look at this world, one for the air and one for under the sea. Beneath your feet is a crust of ice and snow that sparkles in the sunlight. A few meters in front of you is the edge of the ice shelf, which drops down into the blue depths. You can't wait to explore these waters because deep down under the ice are some of Earth's first ever animals. What were they and what did they look like? To survey this world, you start up your aerial drone and start to fly over this beautiful icy landscape. It is so quiet that it's kind of eerie, and all you hear is the ice itself making strange and haunting noises as the ice shifts, cracks, pops, and expands. There are deep, ominous groaning noises and a sizzling sound as ancient air bubbles, trapped for millions of years, are finally released into the atmosphere. This is Snowball Earth, our white marble. It is one of the most incredible climate extremes in the history of our planet, a time of runaway climate change that flipped the Earth's state from a hot and balmy water world to an icy, frozen wasteland. It's amazing that life can survive here, but somehow, it did. Our Earth has always alternated between a greenhouse state, in which no continental glaciers exist, or an icehouse state, like the present day, in which ice is present on Earth. We live in exceptional times because the overwhelming majority of Earth's history, about 85%, was a greenhouse world. While our current icehouse Earth is relatively mild, sometimes the icehouse state goes completely wild. This is one of those times. The period you're currently visiting is called the Cryogenian, an appropriately cold-sounding name that means cold birth in Greek. The Earth froze over twice through the 85 million years of the Cryogenian. The first time was the 57 million year long Sturtian glaciation. Then, after it ended and the ice melted, Earth was hit with another snowball Earth, the Maranoan glaciation, that shut the planet down for another 20 million years. If you want an idea of how insanely long this was, combined, that's more time under the ice than the entire Cenozoic era. That's the time that separates the asteroid that caused the dinosaur extinction to the present day. So how can Earth just freeze up? While the cause is still debated, one leading theory is that massive volcanoes in an area called the Franklin Large Igneous Province started erupting in what is now present-day Canada. This eruption was monumental, lasting for over 2 million years and covering 1.1 million square kilometers in lava, an area larger than France and Germany combined. That's a lot of lava, but the real climate change culprit were plumes of volcanic gases like sulfur dioxide, which is pumped into the upper stratosphere, reflecting sunlight away from the planet and causing runaway cooling. But maybe not all the Earth was frozen. It's thought that there might have been a ring of melted seawater that stretched around the warmer regions of the equator. Instead of snowball Earth, we call this semi-melted Earth a slushball Earth, and it's becoming a widely accepted theory. It's a pretty cool idea, and it makes sense for the survival of life. Organisms like photosynthetic bacteria and green algae need light to survive, so they must have been near to the surface of open water to receive light. But wait a second. The Proterozoic is almost 2 billion years long, and your excursion to the Cryogenian ice shelf is right near the end of the entire eon, so much more happened during the Proterozoic, and this is a good chance to discover what the rest of it was like. Let's take a tour through time, first rewinding to 2.5 billion years ago, the beginning of the Eon. If you thought the slush ball Earth of the Cryogenian was weird, that was nothing compared to the start of the Proterozoic. There was an even longer snowball Earth, 2.4 billion years before the present day. It was the Huronian glaciation, and it froze the Earth for over 300 million years. The first period of the Proterozoic is called the Siderian. This is where glaciation began, and it carried over into the Ryacian period. What's especially amazing is that this one wasn't caused by the power of volcanoes. It was caused by bacteria. For most of the Proterozoic, single-celled prokaryotes dominated the Earth. The Eon is even named after them, meaning earlier life in Greek. In the early Proterozoic between 2.4 to 2.1 billion years ago, bacteria called cyanobacteria were profiting from an unchallenged survival strategy. They were photosynthesizers, using chlorophyll to convert sunlight into energy, just like plants do. Every time a photosynthetic reaction occurs, water and carbon dioxide are converted to glucose, sugar, and oxygen gas, a potent and reactive wildcard of an element. While we need oxygen to survive today, back in the early Proterozoic, oxygen was almost non-existent in the ocean or the atmosphere. But after hundreds of millions of years of cyanobacteria floating around and photosynthesizing, they were releasing large amounts of oxygen. For a while, elements in the ocean such as iron reacted with this oxygen, which precipitated out as iron oxide, staining the oceans green and locking iron and oxygen away in rocks, called banded iron formations. Eventually, the free iron ran out, and the banded iron formations stopped. A tipping point had arrived, and the oxygen needed somewhere else to go. It dissolved directly into the water and rose up into the atmosphere. For aerobic life in the oceans, oxygen was a poison, and many prokaryotes were wiped out forever in Earth's first mass extinction. Meanwhile, in the hazy orange atmosphere, oxygen flooded into the air and transformed its composition. The first ozone layer was forming as O2 oxygen was split by solar radiation and reformed into O3 ozone molecules. More free oxygen reacted with the abundant methane, which was giving the sky its strange polluted color. Methane was broken into water and carbon dioxide. As methane dropped and oxygen soared, the sky turned blue for the very first time. There was another effect. Methane is a powerful greenhouse gas that traps heat and warms the planet, and when it went away, the temperature of the Earth plummeted. Oceanic water froze into ice sheets from pole to equator. We call this event the Great Oxygenation Event. If you visited the Proterozoic just after the Huronian glaciation, let's say 2.023 billion years ago during the Orosirian period, you'd find yourself walking on the surface of a hostile, empty continent called Nuna. If you timed things just right, you might witness an almighty asteroid impact that created the Vredefort impact structure, the largest and one of the oldest surviving craters on Earth, stretching out between 170 to 300 kilometers wide. The continent of Nuna survived throughout the Statherian period before breaking up during the Kalimian 1.5 billion years ago. One amazing product from this violent continent splitting are rare pink diamonds which were being formed under intense tectonic plate pressure. Nuna was no more, but a new supercontinent was coming together, Rodinia. From roughly 1.26 billion years ago to 633 million years ago, from the Ectasian through the Stenian and into the Tonian, all of Earth's land was condensed into this impressive super landform. Let's check back in at the Orosirian period, around 2 billion years ago. Sometime around here, the eukaryotic cell had evolved, joining bacteria and archaea as the third and final domain of life. These eukaryotes would branch out into all the animals, plants, fungi, and protists that are around today, from yeast to blue whales to pine trees to tardigrades. In this bacterial world, the eukaryotes were the new giants of the deep. Eukaryotes are much more beefed up compared to the simple prokaryotic cell. For starters, the eukaryotic cell is huge, around 100 to 10,000 times larger than a bacterial cell. Inside, the DNA is housed in a nucleus where it wraps histone proteins that add structure and support. Other organelles such as vacuoles, ribosomes, and the endoplasmic reticulum perform many other metabolic functions. Some of the organelles of eukaryotes, such as ribosomes and the chloroplasts of plant cells, even have their own genomes, which suggest that they started out as prokaryotic cells that were eaten up by a eukaryotic cell and decided to live there, a symbiotic relationship known as endosymbiosis. Let's move ourselves to 1.8 billion years ago. The Great Oxidation Event and the Huronian glaciations were done and dusted, and the Earth had settled in as a hot, steaming ocean world. It's an exciting time. The oceans were crawling with single-celled organisms, both prokaryotes and eukaryotes, and life was becoming more complex. The stage seemed set for life to diversify across the Earth. Complex protists were evolving rapidly. Conditions seemed right for evolution to move into overdrive. But instead, the Earth entered a billion-year period of stability in which it seemed like nothing much happened. This time period was even given a catchy name by the paleontologist Martin Brasier. He called it the Boring Billion. Between about 1.8 to 0.8 billion years ago, the greenhouse climate had stabilized. The Earth itself was stabilizing. The length of the day, which was as short as 6 hours per day during the early Earth, remained steady at around 19 hours per day during the Boring Billion. Plate tectonics slowed down. And what about the evolution of life? It seemed to have stagnated. It might have done so because of the limited tectonic plate movements. When the Earth's crust isn't being folded up into mountains, crushed into valleys, or subducted into the mantle, then there just aren't many new minerals dissolving into the oceans for organisms to live off. And without new minerals, life just kind of stayed put. The Boring Billion sounds pretty boring, but some things were actually happening in the deep blue depths. The first true plant cells split from the rest of eukaryotes around 1.538 billion years ago. Animals and fungi, which are more closely related, split into their own two groups shortly afterwards. By the time the Boring Billion ended, about 800 million years ago during the Tonian period, evolution was finally ramping up again. Multicellular organisms were here in the Cryogenian, and it's time to go underwater to check them out. You've just launched your underwater drone, and you watch with interest at the screen as it passes through the clear blue water. The water here is much shallower than you expected, and you soon reach the ocean floor. There is still enough light for life to thrive. The ocean floor is flat and green-brown, made of a gooey microbial mat created by billions of years of cyanobacteria buildup. On top of the wavy surface of the microbial mat, you clearly see tiny whitish shapes speckled everywhere. They look like grains of rice, and when your drone camera zooms in, you see tiny pores illuminated by the lights of the drone. They're sponges, probably the first multicellular organism that existed on Earth, and most likely the largest animals on Earth at this time. The earliest known sponge fossils are 780 million years old. They are called Otavia antiqua, and they were discovered in the Gorb rock formation in present-day Namibia. Otavia are tiny creatures, just a third of a millimeter to half a centimeter long, with a hollow body and pores along their surface. They have no organs, but they do have a rigid structure through which they can pump water and filter out bacteria and plankton. While they can't move, they do produce a chemical called collagen, which is enough to classify them as an animal. Another creature catches your eye. It's difficult to be sure with your camera, but you think you see minuscule comb jellies floating around near the Otavia colonies. Comb jellies, also called ctenophores, are another early animal that had their start in the Proterozoic. They are one of two main jelly groups, along with the cnidarians, which also evolved in the Precambrian. However, the cnidarian jellies are not closely related to these ctenophore comb jellies. Instead, cnidarians are part of a separate phylum that includes corals and sea anemones. Comb jellies are made up of two cell layers, just a few cells thick. An outer layer provides protection, and an inner layer is to digest food. They have no bones, no brain, and no blood, and their bodies are filled with watery gel. They move through the water by beating their cilia, small hair-like structures arranged in a comb shape, which gives them their name. Because the soft bodies of jellies don't fossilize well, it's not yet known when exactly the first comb jellies evolved, or if they arose before or after the sponges. In fact, the questions about which phylum branched off the animal kingdom tree first is still debated, with some models suggesting sponges and others the comb jellies. Animals like sponges and jellies needed something to eat, and at the end of the Proterozoic, there were many meals for them to enjoy, as other eukaryotic organisms evolved into different shapes and sizes. Early plant cells like red algae and green algae first appeared around 1 billion years ago. Single-celled organisms called protists, basically any eukaryote that isn't an animal, plant, or fungus, also appear around this time. One example were the ciliates, which used hair-like cilia, like the comb jellies, to move through the water. The protists were among the first organisms to reproduce sexually, exchanging genetic material with other protists. As you walk down a steep glacier to retrieve your drone from the water, you notice a tiny pebble embedded in the ice. It's called a drop stone, and you chip it free with an ice pick. You pick it up, it's about the size of a large coin, with red and black stripes, and has been polished and smoothed by the ice. It's a banded iron stone, and it tells the story of generations of cyanobacteria changing our oceans forever. It has just completed its multi-million year journey through a glacier and was about to be dropped down onto the sea floor, where one day it would be embedded in sedimentary rock. Thanks to dropstones like these, we know when and where the global glaciations occurred. It's a good Proterozoic souvenir. Your journey through the Proterozoic Eon is not finished yet, because there's one more period to visit. The kingdoms of animals, plants, and fungi all survived the glaciations to live on into the Ediacaran period. And this one is most definitely worth visiting in a separate journey. The sponges and jellies were going to get company. You're about to meet some of the strangest, most puzzling organisms that ever lived. If you're interested in exploring the worlds of deep time, make sure to like and subscribe.